Pope Pius IX authoritatively taught that the state must, has a duty to forbid non-Catholic religions publicly worshiping. Okay, and Benedict the Vatican II completely contradicted that, and Benedict XVI admitted that they that it contradicted that, and Casper, Cardinal quote Casper, who John Paul II and Benedict XVI appointed to quote the position of Christian unity, he admits that before Vatican II, ecumenism was converting people to the Church. He says that this was abandoned after Vatican II. We no longer have the ecumenism of the return. And so they openly admit that they've overturned the traditional teaching of the Church in those areas. And so it doesn't get any more heretical, William. Okay.
Can I reply to that?
Go ahead.
I would disagree with, of course, once again, your misinterpretation of the word heretic. I believe Vatican II is simply reiterating the fact that the state that doesn't and logically could not control the religion of every single individual is impossible. Vatican II doesn't say, and I'd be interested if you could show me it did, that you should choose another religion other than the one that Christ left us, or that it's right to do so, morally correct to do so. Logically, it's impossible for the Church to control the religion of every single individual. It would be impossible. That's not possible. So I think you're completely missing the point of what that's saying.
Well, can I respond to that?
Sure, absolutely.
Okay. The Church teaches, I don't know if you understand this, it doesn't seem like you do, that the state has a duty to forbid the public expression of false religions, okay? The idea that the state can allow all kinds of false religions to worship publicly was condemned in the Syllabus of Errors, because it can't allow, okay, sinful religions and evil and idolatrous religions to publicly spread their evils against Christ and his Catholic faith. And so that idea that religious liberty should be a civil right enshrined in the state was condemned by Pope Pius IX and numerous other popes solemnly. Vatican II taught that the state, that it's a duty for the state to give the civil right to religious liberty to everyone. Okay, and it even goes so far as to say that the state exceeds the limits of its authority if it takes upon itself to direct or to prevent religious activity. That is directly contrary to the teaching of the Church. It is exactly what was condemned by Pope Pius IX in the Syllabus of Errors. He said, he condemned this: men immigrating in a particular place should be allowed to have the public exercises of any form of worship condemned. And so, and in fact, after Vatican II, Catholic constitutions, such as the Catholic Constitution of Spain, was changed. They didn't allow false religions to publicly spread their teachings, but after Vatican II, they rewrote their constitutions to allow false religions to spread their evils. And so that is the heresy of Vatican II in action. And just to close the point off, Benedict XVI admits that this teaching of Vatican II, he says in Principles of Catholic Theology, page 381, we might say that in conjunction with the texts on religious liberty and world religions, Vatican II's teaching is a revision of the syllabus of Pius IX, a kind of counter-syllabus. End quote. And so he admits that the teaching of Vatican II on religious liberty directly contradicts Catholic teaching.
I have a question for you. It's as you mentioned, is a civil right the same as a moral right?
No.
Okay. Once more, I would reiterate the fact that you went on and on about this, simply missed the point that I'm simply pointing out that Vatican II is simply reiterating the fact the state doesn't and cannot control the religion of every single individual. I'll point out the very same truth as I can point it out. I travel a lot over there, Mexico. It's impossible for the state to be able to control the religion of every single individual. So in a sense, it is different, because it is impossible to control the faith, and it's impossible to coerce an individual into believing the faith. That simply isn't a Catholic teaching, that you must force a faith on an individual. I mean, it's not biblical, it's not historical Catholic teaching at all. In that sense, I would completely disagree with your interpretation.
Well, yeah, what you brought up has nothing to do with what I said or what Vatican II taught. Vatican II is addressing the issue of, can the state forbid, okay, people from expressing their own religious beliefs, whatever they may be, publicly? And Vatican II says, no, it cannot do that. It says it exceeds its authority if it takes it upon itself to direct or to prevent religious activity. And it says that the civil rights of religious liberty should be enshrined in the law of every ideal state. That is directly contrary to what the Church teaches.
So your opinion is that Vatican II, that the state could control the religion of every individual, and that Vatican II should have said that. Is that what your opinion is?
The teaching of the Church is, which is also my position, is that, as Pope Leo XIII said in Libertas, justice therefore forbids, and reason itself forbids, the state to be godless, or to adopt a line of action which would end in godlessness, namely to treat the various religions as they call them alike, and to bestow upon them equal rights and privileges. Vices which corrupt the heart should be diligently repressed by public authority. End quote. That's the teaching of Pope Leo XIII, that's the teaching of the Catholic Church, and that's what Vatican II denies.
Well, I completely disagree. I think Vatican II is denying the fact that the state could control the religion of every individual, and I reject your interpretation of that. But
well, you also reject Benedict XVI's interpretation, because he admits that it's a correction. He admits that it's counter to Pius IX's teaching.
I don't agree that he admits that it's a correction. What I think Benedict XVI is saying is the same thing as Vatican II is saying, that the state cannot control the religion of every individual. Things are very different nowadays. You can see that it's impossible for the Church to control what every single individual publicly professes. Simply isn't logical. It's impossible in the way the world is. It's not possible.
No, it's addressing... Go ahead.
And I think the fact that it's, as you were going to say, it's addressing the public confession of individuals. It's impossible to prevent.
It's addressing the concept of, if the state can do it, does it have the right to do it? That's what it's saying, okay? If it doesn't have the manpower to do it, then it's obviously not an issue. It's talking about the ideal state, okay?
Right.
What states are allowed to do, what they can do. It has nothing to do with what you're talking about. But let me ask you this. Does a Catholic esteem false religions, and do these Vatican II, quote, popes, anti-popes, esteem other religions?
Does the Catholic faith esteem other religions? I assume you mean, do they praise other religions?
Yeah, that's what esteem means. Look upon with admiration. Look upon as something good.
I guess if you were to examine certain aspects, even whether they be in ignorance or not, we can definitely find the biblical mandate as well as in Paul in Acts chapter 17. He's praising the pagans for being religious. He doesn't support or endorse their teachings, but he says that in every respect that they're religious. And he praises them for being religious, and then he then says that they need to turn their minds towards Christ now, because they were worshiping in an ignorant fashion. So in that sense, I guess it does praise other religions, but it should praise their religiosity and then turn them towards Christ.
No, he's not praising their religiosity. He's simply acknowledging the fact that they at least admitted that they didn't know God, because they were praying to the unknown God. And so by the fact that they admitted that they did not know God, they were a step closer than the utter pagans who claimed to know God but were actually worshiping devils. The Catholic Church does not esteem false religions.
Are you telling me that Paul is not praising the Athenians?
No, he's not. He doesn't praise false religions. And I'll just quote Pope Leo XIII, who says...
He's calling them very religious. He uses the Greek word daimon. How can you tell me here that he's not praising them? I suggest maybe you could open the Bible right now and read Acts chapter 17, verse 22. I mean, maybe you can explain to me what Paul means when he tells the pagans that they are religious. They're very religious, he tells them, in every respect. He later proceeds to say that the pagans are offspring of God. Use the Greek term genos.
Yeah, and what you're saying is completely ridiculous. And in fact, because...
How about you refuted them?
Yeah,
like,
okay, if you would let me, I will. He says right there, he says, but Paul, standing in the midst, said, ye men of Athens, I perceive that in all things you are too superstitious. Okay? This is the Douay Rheims translation. Let me finish. Okay, let me finish. Too superstitious. So the fact that they are engaging in a form of religious worship, he's not saying it's good. And in fact, in the very next verse, he says, for passing by and seeing your idols, I found an altar also.